Chris provided a wonderful introduction to what I'd like to say, and my real question is, what kind of software does the human brain use to compute? Now, we'll look at computation in a little more detail. And one of the things I want to say about computation is that the term or the word by itself doesn't really have a precise meaning unless you talk about the model on which the computation is being done. And so this talk will really be about models of computation. And I'm awed by the brain, especially trying to think about what kind of model of computation does it use. If we could go to the first slide. The next. So this talk really had its origins in the mid-1980s when I was on sabbatical at Stanford University. I participated in a lunchtime discussion group that had some medical doctors, some medical researchers, mathematicians, physicists, and I was a computer scientist in this discussion group. And what we were talking about was, what would constitute an adequate computer model for the human brain? I was particularly interested in, at that time, and I'm still very interested in, what kind of algorithms does the brain use to compute? And one time I asked one of the medical doctors two questions. I asked him, do you know Jonathan Xavier Einstein? And he immediately responded, no, I don't. Then I asked him, what is the longest English word that you know that has no repeated letter in it? And he said, I'm going to have to think about that for a while. Then I said to him, the first question you answered instantly. The second one you said you'll have to think about for a while. So clearly, I conclude from this that the brain must use more than one algorithm to process information. Could you tell me at least one algorithm that the brain is known to use? His response at that time was, what's an algorithm? So that was over 30 years ago. Neuroscientists today are well aware of what an algorithm is. And if we go to the next slide, here is the traditional computer science definition of an algorithm. It follows what Don Knuth used in his monumental series of books, The Art of Computer Programming. Now, if we go to the next slide, underneath this definition, there is an assumed model of computation, because we said an algorithm consists of instructions. They're instructions on some kind of computing machine. And in computer science, we traditionally use Turing machines if we want to look at computation theoretically, and the random access machine if we're more interested in programs and algorithm design techniques. There's a third model of computation, the lambda calculus, which is equivalent to Turing machines and random access machines in the sense that all three of these models that can compute exactly the same class of functions. If we move to the next slide, when Jeanette Wing was the director of the Computer and Information Science and Engineering Directorate of the United States National Science Foundation, she wrote a paper in which she thrust the term computational thinking into everyone's vocabulary. And to Jeanette, He said that computational thinking is as important to a 21st century citizen as reading, writing, and arithmetic. What she meant by computational thinking and what I mean by computational thinking is summarized in the next slide. So computational thinking is a two-step process. First, you create a mathematical abstraction for formulating problems in the area that you're interested in, and you'd like the mathematical abstraction to be such that you can then create solutions for those problems using computation steps and algorithms. I might mention that creating the appropriate model of computation can sometimes be a daunting challenge. And I use as an example the development of quantum mechanics as a model of computation, which underlies the techniques we are using today to try to solve problems on quantum computers. If we move to the next slide, it just reiterates the issue of models of computation, saying that virtually every programming language that we use today embodies some model of computation. And programming languages often have distinctive models of computation depending on what class of problems they were created to address. So if we move to the next slide, we come to the main essence of this talk, namely that software is the combination of algorithms and programming languages. There are several websites that say that the internet is the top invention of humankind that has changed the world. The internet is driven by software, and if we look at the companies represented in this slide from Intel, almost all of these companies are now multi-billion dollar a year companies, but they didn't exist 20 years ago. And the amount of information that is being transferred on the internet in a minute is staggering. What is even more interesting is that the prediction that in another 2 or 3 years, there'll be many more times as many connected devices than there are people on the planet. So the internet certainly has changed society, how we do business, and how we communicate with one another. If we move to the next slide, I don't think I have to actually show this slide to this audience, but when I teach my programming languages and compilers course, I start by asking the students 3 questions. So let's go to the first question. How much software does the world use today? Let's take all of the software systems that are used by people, governments, universities, industrial organizations, and so on. But don't count duplicate systems more than once. Every software system is written in a higher level language. What is the total number of source lines of code that have been used to create the software systems that the world depends on? I'm astonished at the fact that no student seems to know how much software there is in the world today. Usually I get a brave student who puts up their hand and says, 1 million lines of code. And then I point out to them that Microsoft Windows XP, the operating system, is somewhere between 60 and 80 million lines of source code. The SAP, people management system, is over 200 million lines of source code. So I did a guesstimate, and I estimate, if we go to the next line, that there are probably over a trillion lines of source code that have been used to create the software systems that the world uses today. And Chris mentioned the issue of maintenance that this begets. Maintenance is a significant issue associated with software. But let's go to the next question on the slide. What is the cost of the legacy base of software that the world uses? And in an article that I wrote in Science Magazine 10 years ago, I guesstimated that a finished, documented, tested line of software costs about $10 to $100 to create. And so if we have a trillion lines of software with a cost of $10 to $100 per line, this is a staggering sunk cost in the legacy software base. What this also means is that the software systems that are in use today are not going to be replaced anytime soon because there isn't enough ROI to do it. And the programming languages that have been used to create these software systems are going to be used into the foreseeable future, at least in maintenance mode. If we go to the next line, one more line. Now it starts to become interesting. What is the defect density of software? And these defect densities, accurate data on this is very hard to obtain. But talking to a few key people, I estimated that defect densities ranged from anywhere between 10 defects to 10,000 defects per million lines of software. I only met two organizations that could produce this ultra-reliable software. These were the people who were creating software for therapeutic medical devices and people who were creating software for deep space missions. But the typical industrial defect density seemed to be somewhere between 1,000 and 10,000 defects per million lines of software. Let's go to the next line, next slide. Next slide, please. Just to look at the dimensions of the software industry, there are thousands of programming languages in use today. Some aren't used very much, but if you look at the most popular languages, you'll see that many of them, almost all of them, are C-based languages, and they've been around for a long period of time. Java, C, C++ are decades-old languages. We see occasionally a new language creeping into TILB's top 10 list, languages like Ruby. But the most software development is still being done with the legacy languages, and certainly in maintenance mode, you have to be familiar with these legacy languages. You might ask, why are there so many programming languages in the world? And if we go to the next slide, we see that there's the observation that one language cannot serve all application areas equally well. And if you talk to programmers, you discover that programmers are amongst the most opinionated people on the planet. They have strongly held opinions about what a good programming language is. And there are all sorts of interesting discussions about why one language is better than another. Usually the language that you're using you think is the best language in the world. But even today, there is no universally accepted metric for the goodness of a programming language. But even the legacy languages that we have today, if we go to the next slide, we see that there are powerful evolutionary forces that are changing these languages. We have an increasing diversity of applications, increasing programmer productivity, and shortening time to market are powerful economic factors. And today, computation is very much oriented around cell phones and mobility and distributed computing. And we'll talk about that in a little more detail shortly. So let me talk a little bit about design. How would you design a programming language? And this has some interesting implications for thinking about if we had to design a programming language for creating software for the brain, what are some of the factors that we might put into the design process? Let's go to the next slide. So I spent almost 30 years at Bell Labs, and I have used this computational thinking model for programming language design in my Programming Languages and Compilers course at Columbia. I've been teaching that course for 20 years. The course has a semester-long programming project. I ask students to work in teams of five, and the problem statement is design an innovative new programming language and write a translator for it. You can choose any problem area you want. You can choose any technology to implement your language. And this course is the most fun and most interesting course I have ever taught, largely because the students are so creative and so imaginative. They create languages that I would never, ever think about assigning as course projects. One of the languages that was created was a language for assigning music to data. One of the people on the team was a more senior graduate student. He was actually a venture capitalist who had created several venture capital companies. And his idea of an interesting language was a language for putting music to data. And he illustrated his language by taking the stock market ticker tape and programming it so when the market was going up, the music was very cheerful and upbeat, and when the market was going down, the music was very somber and glum. I guess if he were running his program today, the music would be very somber and glum, looking at how the stock market was performing. Another language that was very unusual was a language designed by a team that had two women on it. I think the women were actually from India. They were Indian students. And the language they created was called What to Wear. With the language, you could express your fashion style. You put the clothes that you had in your closet into a database, and the program would look up the weather report for where you were traveling to the next day. And then what the program did was make fashion recommendations of what you should wear based on the clothes that you had in your closet and what the weather was going to be like. I can't imagine a team consisting only of men designing that kind of language. But much of the philosophy in this language design came from Bell Labs. And particularly when I worked with Brian Kernahan and Peter Weinberger on the design of the programming language awk. If we go to the next slide, Awk was a language that we created just to satisfy our own needs. We found ourselves doing a lot of routine data processing tasks, and we didn't want to write long C programs to do these. I was teaching some courses, maintaining budgets, doing editorial correspondence, and I just wanted a language where I could write routine data processing programs with a few lines of code and then throw the programs away. The computational thinking behind the language, if we go to the next slide, was that of pattern action programming. Human beings are stimulus response creatures. If we hear a loud noise, we turn our head towards that noise. So my philosophy in the model of computation for this language was that an awk program would be a sequence of pattern action statements. We'd read the input a line at a time or a record at a time and look for patterns, specified patterns in these lines. And if we find a pattern, we'd execute the action associated with that pattern. And if we go to the next slide, we'll see that an awk program is just a sequence of pattern action statements, and the patterns were just Boolean combinations of the numeric and string expressions, and the actions were basically C-like programs. It was an interpreted C-like language that we put in place. And in the next slide, we see some of the very useful programs that you could write with just a single line of awk. That if you wanted to count the number of lines in a file, you could specify the pattern end, which matches after you've read all of the input, and the action is to print this magic variable called number of records that you've seen. And you can see that each of these awk programs is very simple, and you can now be awk users. Let's go to the next slide. The reason I include this slide is that I'm a big fan of saying that the best theory is motivated by practice, and the best practice is motivated by theory. So when I first joined Bell Labs, I spent a certain amount of time on trying to find efficient string pattern matching algorithms, and these got incorporated into awk. New languages, particularly Perl, came along and took over a lot of the functionality that was present in awk, but Perl did not use these efficient string pattern matching algorithms. And what this chart shows, this chart was prepared by Russ Cox, not by me, that if you take a simple regular expression pattern, namely a question mark, taken n times, followed by n a's, and you try matching it on a string of n a's, you see that the Perl program starts taking an amount of time that is comparable to a day or to a week or to a year once the size of the pattern increases to above 30, whereas with awk and Thompson's grep program, you can run those programs in just a fraction of a millisecond, even at these large data spaces. The reason I show this slide is that this is something that Chris mentioned. The human brain can do amazing computations using only 20 watts of power, and we don't know how to simulate what the brain does with 30 megawatts of power. So there is a huge energy efficiency with which the brain can do computation. It might be nice to reverse engineer the algorithm that the brain uses to do computation and incorporated it into our computer systems. Let's move on to the next slide. Let's look at the problem of language translation. Chris mentioned that language is one way by which human beings can communicate knowledge to others, to our children, and to society as a whole. The brain is very good at processing natural languages. We can take a statement in one language, and if we know another language, easily translate it into that other language. If we go to the next slide, we've been doing this with computers for a long period of time in the realm of programming languages. A translating program called a compiler maps a source program into a semantically equivalent target program. And if we go to the next slide, we see that there are a variety of ways that the programming language community has attempted to describe the semantics of programming languages. But I don't know of any equivalent way of being able to describe the semantics of natural language. People have tried to create denotational semantic descriptions of, say, English, but these really haven't caught on. But yet, intuitively, we have no problem assigning a semantic meaning to an utterance. How does the brain actually do this? If we go to the next slide, with programming language compilers, we're very good at being able to create efficient compilers that map a source program into a target program. The reason we can do this is in the last 50 years, we have learned that we can construct a programming language translator as a sequence of phases where each phase translates one representation of the source program into another representation, usually at a lower level. And the composition of these phases then allows the translation process to occur effectively. In fact, there are compiler collections like GCC and LLVM, where you have a collection of front ends. The front end of a compiler is identified by the phases in the magenta color, and you have a collection of back ends. They're identified by the blue boxes, and you can trade, mix and match front ends with back ends. So you can create, say, a compiler for a new language by creating a front end for that new language and translating it into an intermediate representation, which then an existing back end can use to produce the target program on a given machine. Let's go to the next slide. If we look at natural languages, a baby growing up has no problem learning a natural language. Human beings can't program computers to learn natural languages as well as babies can learn natural languages. There are people who can speak several natural languages, and do they have a separate front end for each natural language that translates that syntax into some intermediate representation the way a compiler does? My understanding is that the neuroscience community really doesn't understand, from a biological point of view, how the brain processes natural language. But yet, natural language is the processing is clearly an information processing task that brains are good at, but computers still have a lot to learn on how to do this. If we move to the next slide, one of the aspects of natural languages is that they're much messier than programming languages. Natural languages are inherently ambiguous. I picked these three examples from a book on natural language, from various books on natural language processing. And I think that civilization probably wouldn't exist if natural languages weren't inherently ambiguous. It would be very difficult if you had to always say the truth in an unambiguous way. And I think a good example of using the inherent ambiguity of natural languages was exemplified by the Oracle at Delphi. So when some famous general came to consult the Oracle, and the general would ask the Oracle, "Am I going to win this battle tomorrow?" The Oracle, the priestess, was smart enough to say, "Tomorrow a great battle will be won." And of course the general, with his ego, thought, of course that means that I'm going to win the battle tomorrow. But programming languages shouldn't be inherently ambiguous. Natural languages probably have to be inherently ambiguous. So we still have a lot to learn about how to process messy languages in an algorithmic way. I'd like to move on to the last phase of my talk to talk about reliable software. Let's go to the next slide. And this is a billion-dollar question for the industry. I mentioned the huge variation in defect densities in industrial software, and most commercial software is in the 1,000 to 10,000 defects per million lines of code. But there are situations where we really need accurate, reliable software, and how do we achieve it? What I'd like to do is tell a story on how one organization is attacking this problem. But let me remind you again of how important a problem this is. Let's look at the next slide. Software is one of the few areas that I know of in which you can spend a quarter of $1 billion or more and have nothing to show for it afterwards. And if we go to the next slide, if you're doing computational science, you should also worry about accurate software. Several prestigious scientific journals like Science had to retract papers because the results in the papers were bogus due to software errors. And if we go to the next slide, there was a paper just published last year in which the author said he estimates that any reported scientific result could very well be wrong if data have passed through a computer. It doesn't give you much confidence in scientific results that are computer results in the even in the scientific literature. And we still haven't gotten good ways of doing peer review for computer-generated software results. But let's move to a nice story on reliable software. Let's go to the next slide. The United States National Aeronautics and Space Administration launched a mission to Mars called the Mars Science Laboratory. And as part of this mission, there was a rover called Curiosity, a robotic rover that NASA sent to Mars to explore the Martian terrain. And the Mars Science Laboratory depends on million lines of software working correctly. If we move to the next slide, the task that NASA had in front of it was daunting. It launched a probe from Earth on the 26th of November in 2011, and on the 5th of August the following year, it landed on the Gale crater on Mars, a distance of 350 million miles. If we move to the next slide, the Gale crater is a very small landing ellipse on Mars. The first thing the rocket had to do was accurately get the rover to this landing site on Mars and then safely land the rover on this in this crater. If we go to the next slide, if you're responsible for this mission, how and what should you do to make sure that the mission would be successful? You'd obviously want to check the hardware to make sure that the hardware was working correctly. But let's go to the next slide. And perhaps an even more daunting task is, how do you make sure that the software is working correctly? A single software error could scrub the entire mission. The Mars Curiosity rover, this Mars software laboratory, had 3 million lines of C code with many parallel threads, and it was complicated code. NASA had been burned by defective software in the past, and they were determined this time to get it right. So one of the things that NASA did, which I thought was a good move on their part, they hired Gerard Holtzman, who used to work for me in the Computing Science Research Center at Bell Labs. And if we go to the next slide, what Gerard did was he instituted a more rigorous tool-based verification process at NASA. They created coding standards with compliance checks done by tools. They developed a certification program to train their flight software developers. They used static analysis tools. They used a combination of code review processes, and Holtzman developed a tool called Scrub to combine their results and then have a systematic way of making sure that every fault or potential fault that was detected by one of the tools was properly processed. And more interestingly, from a research point of view, Holtzman had created a model checking tool called SPIN. And if we move to the next slide, SPIN creates, it has two parts to it. There's a model extraction tool that can work directly on implementation C code. It extracts a model consisting of temporal logic formulae and your specification of how the software should work has been expressed in terms of these logic formulae. So what SPIN does is it checks to make sure that every state that the software can get into, the formulas are not violated. And since Holtzman is a very good software engineer, SPIN allows many tens of millions of software states to be examined very quickly. Let's go to the next slide. So I mentioned that the software on the Curiosity rover had a lot of concurrent code. About 10 or 15 years ago, if you wanted to prove the correctness or verify concurrent code, it had to be done manually, and a proof could take months. So here was an example that Holtzman used. I borrowed these slides from Holtzman. Now, if you use, going to the next slide, if you use the MODEX model extraction tool and SPIN, that software task that took months of manual effort a decade or more ago can now be done in a few seconds. And this was an important part of the software verification process for the Curiosity rover code. SPIN has also been used to verify software for the dikes in Holland and high-speed trains in Italy. So let's go to the next slide. So what happened with this new software verification process? Holtzman pointed out that in the previous software mission to Mars, the mission lost 26 days of operation due to software bugs. In the first year, the Curiosity rover only lost one day to a single bug. So I view this as a very heartening result that with the right kind of software verification tools and processes, we can significantly improve the quality of mission-critical software. So let me conclude. Let's go to the next slide. So Partha Mitra and I have been talking about what might constitute a good model of computation for the human brain. So I took his question to heart and I turned it into a computer science question. And I posed the computer science question to every computer scientist that I could meet. So if there are any of you who would like to attack this problem, I welcome your response. Last year, or in 2014, Addison Wesley had a celebration for the publication of Don Knuth's The Art of Computer Programming and invited a bunch of people to submit questions to Don Knuth. He selected 20 of them, and this is the question that I submitted, and Knuth chose this question as one of the 20 questions that he chose to answer. So the question is, we all know that the Turing machine is a universal model for sequential computation, but let's consider reactive distributed systems that maintain an ongoing interaction with their environment. So systems like the internet, or perhaps the human brain. Is there a universal model of computation for these kinds of systems? I haven't met a computer scientist who's been able to give me an answer to this question, but you might be interested in Knuth's response to this question. Let's go to the next slide. So Knuth began his answer by saying, "I'm not strong on logic," which I find very amusing because everybody who read this particular website picked up on this logic, picked up on this statement and said, "Knuth is not strong on logic." He then continued, if we go to the next slide, that he very much wanted to talk about concurrent and cooperative processes after he finishes The Art of Computer Programming. Since he's only on volume 4 at this point, I don't know whether he'll ever get to writing chapter 8. But then if we look at the next part of his answer, the next slide, he very much would like to see an answer to this question. He'd like to see extensions of the set theoretic model of computation that he had used in his books and hopefully get insights onto distributed reactive system. And then I thought the last part of his answer was very humbling. Next slide, please. But he says, "Fully distributed processes are well beyond the scope of my books and my own ability to comprehend them." So if Knuth can't comprehend distributed processes, who can? And then he goes on to say that for a while he thought that the way ant colonies perform their tasks might be a key to understanding human cognition. But then he says the ants that invade his house baffle him. So let me conclude with the open question, the next slide. Is there a universal model of computation for reactive distributed systems that maintain an ongoing interaction with their environment? Because if you came up with this kind of model, and if you think that the human brain is a reactive distributed system that maintains an ongoing interaction with its environment, you would also be producing a model of computation for the brain. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Aho, for joining us via this remote link. Do we have any questions from the audience?
Professor Aho, this is Chris here. We seed a system or a application, but then the application is robust enough to maintain itself on an ongoing basis, sustain itself, is able to repair itself on an ongoing basis, and learn over time to do new things. Wouldn't that be a more, or wouldn't that be a better model when you think about distributed systems that maintain an ongoing interaction? Because that interaction could be anything tomorrow. You know, we don't know what the interaction will be in the future.
That is a very good question. I haven't defined what I meant by an ongoing interaction. If we look at the internet is, the hardware is changing, the links are changing, they go up and down, new servers get put on the internet. So it has this property that the system is dynamically changing as well as doing its ongoing interaction with the outside. If we look at the development of a human embryo from fertilized egg to adulthood, there's certainly a lot of development of the embryo as well as interaction with the environment. So that, I think, is a very important aspect of this kind of system. How we define the permissible interactions is interesting. There are some models for reactive distributed systems in the literature. One that gets mentioned fairly frequently is Carl Hewitt's actor model of computation. And if you look at some of the, even the legacy languages like C++, there is a C++ actor foundation. And there are some new languages like Elm that use the actor model for distributed computation. I don't know whether the actor model is a good model for the brain, but it's at least a step up from the Turing machine model, where the Turing machine model doesn't consider time and it doesn't consider ongoing interaction. But that's a great question.
One theme that kind of came up throughout the morning that I was struck by again is the issue of, in some sense, noise. So the machines that perform the computation we've made very precise, but we are introducing errors because of programming bugs and so on and so forth. So in some sense, noise is creeping in despite our best efforts to make the underlying hardware reliable. I wonder, I mean, it's a theme that has occurred in the past with, you know, von Neumann and Shannon looking at noisy elements, but they wanted to make precise computers out of those noisy elements. But I wonder if, you know, this is a different way of thinking about computation. If you allow noise, you know, one has to almost throw out the rule book and start again, but wonder what your thoughts are about that.
Well, that's that again is a very good question, because we, even with our current computer systems, we've had to develop mechanisms to cope with noise and with errors. Even if we write a compiler, what happens if you attempt to compile a C program with a Python compiler? How long do you let the Python compiler run before you ask it to throw up its hands? And if we look at quantum computation, one of the biggest stumbling blocks in quantum computation is coping with noise, with interference with the environment. So in the world of quantum computation, people have developed quantum error correcting codes in order, in an attempt to put some control and get some statistical reliability on the computations that get chosen. If we look at exascale supercomputing, if you have a billion processors, what's the chance that all billion processors will be functioning at the end of an hour? So being able to build fault tolerance and error correction into the computing environment is particularly important for these exascale supercomputers. So I think you've identified a critical problem. I don't know that we have adequate solutions for these problems yet.
I had a question. When neuromorphic computing becomes a reality, what would be the key issues in designing programming languages and programming environments for neuromorphic computing?
Neuromorphic computing is an interesting model of computation. I'm not an expert in it, but from what I understand, you try to program in terms of sequences of spikes rather than constant signals. And that may be a model that's more close to how the human brain does computation by looking at trains of spikes. But it still gets down to this issue of what kind of algorithm design techniques do you want to, should you know about? The great thing about the random access machine model is that it allows us to think about algorithm, powerful algorithm design techniques like divide and conquer, dynamic programming. If we have these more exotic models of computation, each of them is going to require some algorithm design techniques. I don't know the neuromorphic computing model well enough to understand, do they have good algorithm design techniques for them?
Professor, the recent advances, especially in deep learning, does neural network-based computation provide a starting point for what you're calling as distributed and reactive computing, especially those neural networks which have continuous learning as part of their...
Well, maybe I've picked up too much influence from Partha. Partha has said that neurobiologists like to have biologically inspired models of computation, and there's reason to believe that the neural nets are not a biologically inspired model of computation. So maybe I should have Partha answer that question.
Well, I think a telltale sign is that these models are actually being implemented on the hardware, which is von Neumann machines. We are still relying on a different universal model of computation. Things haven't really changed. You know, these are sequential operations. So I think the word artificial is important in front of the neural network. These are still artificial neural networks. I think it's opened up a dialogue in terms of thinking about graphs, thinking about distributed computing. But I think I was struck by what Al said in the beginning about software being a sum of algorithms plus programming languages. And think about what programming languages you're using to code the deep networks up. So I don't think things have fundamentally changed yet. But I think at the same time, the fact that people are very motivated, one of the interesting things about this conference I found was that the machine learning talks were packed and there was people sitting in the overflow rooms, whereas some of the biology talks, we had a few empty chairs. We are seeing a disconnect between the biological studies of the brain and, you know, the more artificial neural networks, and that has been there in the community, and part of the goal of this workshop is to try to bridge that disconnect, bring it back. So the fact that we are having the workshop, I think in some sense shows that these artificial networks have been influential in bringing us together, but it's not enough. I think we have to take the next step.
So one thought I have here is, if you look at nature, there are two models where some kind of programming is there. It's in the DNA, where, it has used perfect replication as a way to ensure that, that program is sustained over many generations, over many millions of years, actually. And then we have the brain, which is using a different technique to actually think and, create algorithms and programs and things like that. And of course, we are learning, and that learning allows us to use our organs differently or, limbs differently. We learn new capabilities. A couple of days back, we had a fantastic music performance, and you can't think when performing music. It is automatic, actually, and so that means the brain has programmed itself to actually play. It's programmed itself to play, and I would assume so. That's the second level of programming that the brain and nature has created, and that's why I separated out the DNA and the brain as two separate things to look at. Now, if you want to create a distributed system which has got, the need to interact with the environment and sustain itself and protect itself, is the DNA kind of programming better than the brain kind of programming, is my question. Now, what computers are is using the brain kind of programming. But when it comes to a distributed system, which we are not going to touch, we are going to leave it there and expect it to work for many, many years to come, we'll have to go back to the DNA kind of programming, build redundancy based on that, error correction based on that, et cetera, et cetera, is what I feel.
Obviously, there has been work on genetic algorithms and use of genetic algorithms for decision support systems. But I do agree that that's why I said it's a starting point. And the need for it to exactly replicate biology, I put it as second to the need to meet a need which exists in the market, I guess, as an industrialist.
I think we should let Professor Ho have the last word.
Well, I'm impressed at the profundity of these questions, and you know, programmers have a lot of opinions on what constitutes a good programming language, and I'm certainly not in a position to constitute, is DNA a better computing model than the model used in the brain? I don't know what the right metric of comparison would be, but this is a great question for the biologists. Thank you. Good luck with the conference.